today we're going to be looking more closely into the debate about the role of government in economic development. Now this issue, which ought not to be too controversial, was rather split within the economics community, the policy-making community, between two broad strands. One group who said that you need markets to work by themselves, and another group that said, well, you need a strong state to control and steer economic development, particularly in developing countries. So this market-oriented versus developmental state view were more or less split down the middle. This debate became prominent in the 1990s because the gulf between what was happening in East Asia and what was happening in Latin America and the rest of the world was becoming way too obvious. So we'll be looking at two readings. The first is from the 1991 World Bank report, the World Development Report, a chapter from there. And second is an introduction, the early part of Aoki et al.'s review of economic development and the role of government. This is what the cover of the 1991 World Development Report looks like, the challenge of development. And here is chapter 7, Rethinking the State. The important thing for government is not to do things which individuals are doing already and to do them a little better or a little worse, but to do those things which at present are not done at all. This is a quote from John Maynard Keynes. So the chapter begins by saying, the agenda for reform that has emerged in the course of this report calls for governments to intervene less in certain areas and more in others, for the state to let markets work where they can, and to step in promptly and effectively where they cannot. In many countries, this calls for a stronger orientation toward the market and a more focused and efficient public sector role. History suggests that this is the surest path to faster growth, productivity, rising incomes, and sustained economic development. So this is the mantra that the World Bank generates in 1991. But by the time we come to 1996, when Aoki et al. Are responding to the World Bank's position, the bank has come out with another document called the East Asian Miracle, where they have substantially changed their view. So I just wanted to give you a sense of how these views about the role of government during the 1990s take on multiple directions. So the bank recognizes that political instability is a fact of life in many countries. The past 40 years have seen scores of racial, tribal, communal, and guerrilla wars. Coup d'etat have occurred in many of the Latin American countries, except in Mexico, Costa Rica, and a few Caribbean island nations. In many North African and Middle Eastern countries, for example, Algeria, Egypt, Islamic Republic of Iran, Iraq, Lebanon, Libya, etc., and in many parts of Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. Since 1948, there has been at least one coup attempt per developing country every 5 years. So the fact of political instability in developing countries, in the global south, and the context for that violence we've already seen in Fanon's work. So try and keep this continuity in mind as you're going through these readings. Again here, a nice figure on at least between 1850 and 1987, how the world was divided into different political systems. And you see, well, this color coding is a bit odd. I'm not sure where various things are. I'm not able to distinguish these different colors. But clearly, all you can say is, if you're thinking about the parliamentary system, that's not the dominant system, at least until the 1980s, the mid-1980s, you don't see the yellow actually dominating different types of nation states. But you do notice this, you see this big increase in the total number of nation states after about 1950, and clearly that is a result of some kind of decolonization, the birth of new nations in the second half of the 20th century is, of course, a very, very important aspect of what has changed to states. You see, table 7.1 shows that low-income countries are more likely to have irregular executive transfers than high-income countries, and that trend has remained more or less constant in the second half of the 20th century. Programs of public expenditure have financed the underpricing of utilities, water, electricity, telecommunications, railway or city transport, and have supported untargeted food subsidies. So something important to remember is by this time, by 1991, the World Bank and the IMF have suddenly woken up to the fact that the financing of public utilities in developing countries is an expensive matter, and they're not very happy with public financing of these services. They're not very happy with the public financing of these services. And in fact, they're starting to say that these are inefficient, these are expensive, there are too many subsidies, and so on. By the 1980s, persistent difficulties in financing external and public sector deficits made the costs of these interventions plain to see. When the supply of external finance dwindled after 1982, demands for special treatment outran the economy's capacity to deliver. This term, market failure and government failure, is introduced not for the first time, but certainly starts to become a prominent theme. As the earlier chapters of this report made clear, intervention by the public sector is not undesirable in itself. On the contrary, many sorts of intervention are necessary, are essential, rather, if economies are to achieve their full potential. An abbreviated list of indispensable interventions would include the maintenance of law and order, the provision of public goods, investments in human capital, the construction and repair of physical infrastructure, and the protection of the environment. In all these areas, and arguably more, markets, quote-unquote, fail, and government must step in. But the countless cases of unsuccessful intervention suggest the need for caution. Markets fail, but so do governments. So this theme of how do we balance market failures and government failures becomes quite prominent, starting with the 1991 World Bank report. Governments are prone to fail, at least in economic terms, for a variety of reasons. As noted above, economic goals may not be their highest priority. A combination of political objectives and constraints and weak administration may lead governments to intervene in ways that are economically harmful. Also, the consequences of economic interventions are difficult to predict. So this is a theme around protection for manufacturing in the early stages of industrialization can only succeed, if at all, as long as it is temporary. Recall Harjun Chang's argument about the infant industry, you know, what he says about the 19th century and how industrialized countries of the world, you know, went ahead and did that, particularly America, North America, and Britain before that. But here the bank is saying, well, you can do this temporarily and do this in a manner that once, and then of course, once protection is granted, it is exceptionally difficult to remove. Protection creates rents. Owners of some labor, capital, or land obtain higher returns than they would in the absence of intervention. So the idea here is that if you have government intervention and protection of industries, then you're going to create some winners and losers. You're going to protect certain types of players, and that's going to reduce the scope of competition. To a large extent, one can understand that argument. It does turn out to be the case that you have more and more oligopolies and monopolies in certain sectors. That the experience of the world post-liberalization in countries of the world where there hasn't been this kind of protection is actually worse. In fact, you do find areas of the world, including the United States, which ostensibly have a lot of competitive markets, but actually what ends up happening is the creation of giants, particularly if you look at internet companies, you know, information technology companies. You know, you have the usual suspects capturing a lot of this space without the explicit protection of government as such. So this argument of how that happens or why that happens isn't quite predicted by this type of reasoning. Protection creates rents. Owners of some labor capital or land obtain higher returns than they would in the absence of intervention. This draws new resources to the protected industry until, at the margin, the rents disappear. Removing the protection penalizes not only the owners who first receive the rents as a windfall, but also those who come later seeking normal returns. Removing the tariff in this case can force into loss the firms that gained least. Thus, even when protection has not been created by industrial interests, protection creates industrial interests. These then become a formidable obstacle to liberalization. The next subtopic is corruption. Corruption is a vast topic. We'll only have a chance to look at this briefly and in a, what I would argue is an abbreviated sense of corruption, thinking about the abuse of public office for private gain. Excessive intervention breeds corruption. Again, the problem is by no means confined to governments or to developing countries. In some countries, it has grown to alarming and destructive proportions. Corruption weakens a government's ability to carry out its functions efficiently. Bribery, nepotism, and venality can cripple administration and dilute equity from the provision of government services, and thus also undermines social cohesiveness. Corruption was identified as a serious problem in ancient China and India, in the Ottoman Empire in the 14th century, in England in the early 1800s. Every other year, a scandal is a reminder that it continues in Europe, Japan, and the United States. Corruption has also contributed to the fate of many governments. It was a major justification for the military overthrow of the Ghanaian civilian government in 1981 and the Nigerian one in 1983, an important theme in 1982 in the Mexican presidential campaign, a major reason for the fall of the government in the Philippines in 86, and a problem the authorities consider of the utmost gravity in the USSR. Discussion here on fighting corruption, I won't go into this. Remedies for corruption and other government failures are democracy and institutions. There's a question mark. Authoritarianism has often been seen as a useful, if regrettable, expedient for effective policy making in the face of political instability. A strongly held view from the 1950s to the 1970s was that development policies took time to bear fruit, and that this was inconsistent with the politics of short-term electoral cycles. Democracies were seen as having a built-in inclination toward populist policies. Benevolent authoritarian regimes led by philosopher despots were needed, it was argued, to push through unpopular reforms and tame an unruly or otherwise ineffective administration. Economies managed with varying degrees of authoritarianism and have made economies that managed with varying degrees of authoritarianism have made progress at different times in the past, for example, Brazil, Chile, Spain, and some East Asian economies. At the same time, some democracy. So this argument about the need for authoritarianism is an old one, but it's actually untrue. It's untrue from the standpoint of economic development. There's a lot of evidence about that, and this section explains that. So I won't go through the argument. I hope you have, and there's a lot in here that you must take as evidence-based and therefore of relevance even today. Then this question of institutions and development, another approach to the problems of political instability, fragile social consensus, and weak governance is to build more effective institutions. So let me just remind you what is meant by the word institution. An institution is not the same as an organization. An institution is a set of rules, both formal and informal, that generate a set of practices in a society to create some kind of stable expectations. So institutions is an extremely broad concept. It encompasses the public bodies through which the state discharges its most fundamental responsibilities, maintaining law and order, investing in essential infrastructure, raising taxes to finance such activities, and so on. The idea goes further. It extends to the conventions that govern the way people deal with each other, property rights, contracts, and norms of conduct. So please also take a look at this rather succinct but very important section on institutions, and then the contribution of institutional innovations to development over the centuries. Market-mediated transactions have been a major force in institutional development, which in turn has been a major force in economic development. As markets have expanded, market participants spontaneously have defined rights, formulated contracts, and evolved forms of governance. There's some of this that is contentious, but you should still look at some of the historical arguments or the evidence that is drawn to explain these innovations. And then finally, looking at non-governmental organizations, NGOs have become an important force in the development process, which to some extent has mitigated the costs of developing countries' institutional weaknesses, which often include administrative shortcomings and an inability to carry out efficiently essential development tasks, such as providing social services or protecting the environment. In response, NGOs have grown rapidly in recent years, both in numbers and in the volume of resources they mobilize. In 1987, NGOs transferred about $5.5 billion from industrial to developing countries. Many small NGOs' managerial capacity needs to be developed before they can be effective. For others, little is known about fundraising costs. NGOs, of course, vary in coverage and effectiveness. In Bangladesh, NGOs specialized in health and family planning reach only 1/6 of the country's 80,000 villages. Many small NGOs' managerial capacity needs to be developed before they can be effective. For others, little is known about fundraising costs. In addition, even the most effective NGOs cannot fulfill all the gaps left by the commercial and public sectors. In other words, NGOs, also sometimes called the third wheel of development, have an important role to play, but they cannot replace existing services provided by the private sector and government. Then coming to an issue that has gained much more prominence in recent years, especially with the rise of inequality, this question of redistribution or distribution of income. Governments have always been concerned with equity. Income transfers in OECD countries, excluding interest payments but including social security payments, amount to 40% of government expenditure and are as high as 20 to 30% of GDP in Austria, France, Germany, the Netherlands, and Sweden. A better distribution of income may facilitate economic management. Political scientists have suggested that mechanisms to redistribute income by sharing the benefits of growth more equally have helped some OECD governments to diffuse opposition against market-oriented reforms. Short-term victims of change are cushioned. In other words, this report is saying that, well, the government is spending too much money on providing social security benefits and other kinds of welfare benefits, then that is usually controlled by the government and the market is playing less of a role. So then there's some discussion here about what's the relationship between inequality and growth. And in 1990-1991, the prevailing view was that there isn't much of a relationship. In subsequent decades, the World Bank itself has come around that view and started to say that equality is, or at least inequality, is inimical to greater economic development. And the examples of many countries, including Vietnam, where levels of equality are fairly high, but so are economic growth rates. And so those are those are seen as model countries where reducing inequality leads to better development outcomes. Something also on Sri Lanka and Malaysia, I would urge you to look at them, especially those of you who have these countries as case studies. And then on this whole question of government expenditure, public expenditure, government expenditure accounts for slightly more than 1/5 or 20% of GDP in low-income countries and close to 30% in middle-income ones. These ratios are much lower than in industrial countries today, but much higher than in industrial countries at a comparable stage of development. So there's some more data that is shown there. So let's look at wages and the civil service. Wage bills are a large part of government expenditure in most countries. Before the reform programs, the wage bill absorbed more than 60% of current revenues in the Central African Republic and more than 40% in the Gambia. The tendency to overstaff and underpay that in the last few decades has prevailed in many developed countries means that much of the spending is wasted. The problem of poor motivation has often been compounded by ill-defined career structures and by politicized recruitment and senior appointments. In some countries, the institutional structures and systems originally established to staff and operate the civil service have collapsed. In Uganda, a civil service census turned up not only numerous non-existent workers, but also entire non-existent schools. So these forms of corruption suddenly took on much more importance for organizations like the World Bank around this time. And so this notion of good governance began to take some kind of precedence. And looking at the civil service reform, bureaucratic reform, became something of an obsession. Military spending, that's another big one. Turns out that a lot of developing countries spend a high fraction of their GDP and their budgets on the military. And if some of this money were diverted to poverty reduction programs, there would be what is known as a peace dividend. The world spends $1,000 billion on the military every year. In the late 1980s, military expenditure totaled $860 billion a year. And look, we're talking about a report that's 30 years old. I don't know what current figures are. You may want to look that up. If global military expenditure were reduced, the world would undoubtedly be a better place. But is this realistic? Humanity is no stranger to wars and conflicts, 20th century humanity least of all. The recent war in the Gulf region, ensuing conflicts there, continued violence in Afghanistan, Angola, Central America, and Indochina, civil wars in Ethiopia, Mozambique, Somalia, and Sudan, and one could add to that list today, as I'm sure you're aware, and the snail's pace of superpower disarmament all make it only too clear how difficult progress toward lasting peace will be. Unsurprisingly, military spending is higher in the developing countries that face internal or external threats. Military spending is more than 10% of GDP in several countries, and several examples are given. And in fact, there was a wonderful report that also appeared around this time, probably a few years later, from SDPI, Sustainable Development Policy Institute, which was headed by somebody who had a very prominent role in developing the United Nations Human Development Report, Mehboob al-Haq. And he talks about how much military spending takes place in South Asia. And as you're well aware, particularly tensions between India and Pakistan have caused both countries to increase their military spending as a fraction of their GDP, as a fraction of their budgets. And in Pakistan, the burden is especially high because they're a much smaller economy and they spend much less than India, but it's still a very high fraction of their budget and GDP. And which means that every Pakistani rupee that goes into money spent on the military, on defense, is money that is taken away from schooling, from better healthcare, from clean water, drinking water and sanitation, and so on. So some data here. One of the things, one of the marvelous things about these World Development Reports are the appendices that you find in every report. I am not going to go to the appendix in this one. I would urge you to, because that's where there's a lot of data that is given. When I was about your age, I used to very nerdily go to the appendix, sit and look at the tables along with my nerdy friends and try and look at what was going on in Gambia versus Algeria versus various other countries. And this turns out to be a very, very important thing to do. Bill Gates has said that, the reason he started his foundation was that on one of his retreats when he was chairman of Microsoft, and somebody had given him WHO reports, annual reports, and the World Bank World Development Report and the Human Development Report, and he was poring over the numbers and he couldn't believe his eyes. He couldn't believe that so many millions of people, especially children, were dying from preventable diseases. And so he realized that there was a real opportunity for philanthropy in this area. Good things come out of paying attention to the details, paying attention to the data. So I would hope that at least a few of you try to do this. So this question of state-owned enterprises and privatization, it's a big one. It's a big issue because there's a lot of pressure on governments to privatize state-owned enterprises. Good reasons to do so, but there are also terrible reasons or terrible outcomes if one were to do this without paying attention to what sort of enterprises are being privatized. In the 1980s and 1990s, transferring state-owned enterprises to this private sector has been an important government objective, both in OECD countries such as New Zealand and the United Kingdom, and in developing countries such as Argentina, Brazil, Chile, Ghana, and the Republic of Korea, Malaysia, Mexico, Nigeria, Togo, and Turkey. Now, what the report fails to point out, of course, is that a lot of these types of privatization that took place in developing countries were forced upon them. These were part of structural adjustment programs. Governments have consciously set out to redefine the economic role of the state. As a part of this shift, they have curtailed the state-owned enterprises' privileged access to the budget or credit system, tariff or non-tariff protection for their products, and regulated production protection from private competitors. So looking at privatization is a big topic. I will try to go through some of the discussion in our face-to-face classes, but this is something that I wanted to flag. And this question of reform, what do we mean by reform? How is reform defined? Moving from a centrally planned economy to a market economy, all of these are put in summary form in this report. You know, the real reason why I wanted you to read this report, particularly this chapter in this report, Rethinking the State, is that there's a lot of World Bank thinking that continues to this day that is encapsulated here. And it also reflects a certain shift in thinking. And we need to talk about what that shift entailed. How did that shift come about? The shift was from thinking about market development with the state playing a big role to the state playing perhaps an enabling role, improving its institutions, changing its forms of government, its institutional framework, legal framework, and so on, and trying to then play some kind of a reduced role in economic development. The last paragraph here is worth reading. Reform will remain a formidable task requiring political courage and economic vision. Combining the many different elements described here in other chapters is in itself enormously difficult. The appropriate combination of factors will vary from country to country according to circumstances. And even when reform is well designed, governments are sure to encounter unforeseen setbacks, some of them entirely beyond their control. Development is indeed a challenge, but as history tells us, one that can be met.
So this is the book from which we'll be looking at some chapters. Masahiko Aoki and his colleagues have edited this book. It's called The Role of Government in East Asian Economic Development. Came out in 1996, before the East Asian crisis, economic crisis. And so we'll start with the introduction and the first chapter. The role of government in East Asian economic development has been one of the most contentious issues in economics. Until recently, there has not been a consensus among economists on whether government intervention in the market process played any positive role in the phenomenal economic growth in that region over past decades. Some have forcibly argued that the East Asian economic development can primarily be explained by microeconomic stability that was provided by through proper incentives for investment and saving, as well as high human capital accumulation, while the intervention of government in specific industries was at best irrelevant, or worse, had a harmful and distortive effect on the allocation of resources. In the sense that this view approves only of those government actions that facilitate development and efficiency of markets, it was referred to as the market-friendly view by the World Bank's World Development Report 1991. And that's a chapter from that report has already been assigned to you. The publication in 1993 of a World Bank study, The East Asian Miracle, Economic Growth and Public Policy, may be regarded as a watershed in the debate. The World Bank had been officially committed to the market-oriented non-interventionist development approach in its loan conditionality and policy dialogues. Therefore, the following admission of the study came as news. Each of the high-performing Asian economies maintained macroeconomic stability and accomplished three functions of growth: accumulation, efficient allocation, and rapid technological catch-up. They did this with combinations of policies ranging from market-oriented to state-led that varied both across economies and over time. The project culminating in the present book was initially planned around the time of the publication of the East Asian Miracle. Some of the authors in this project had participated in the earlier World Bank project by preparing background papers, discussing ongoing research and draft reports, presenting papers at seminars, etc. All of us strongly felt the simple division of thought on East Asian economic development between the market-friendly and developmental state views was unproductive and unfortunate. For that reason, we regarded the attempt of the bank study to explore a middle ground by reconciling the market-friendly approach with a cautious, nuanced version of state interventionist view as a useful step. But at the same time, we felt there were still many things left undone. So the purpose of this book, this collection of articles, as it were, comes as a sort of an additional assessment of how to think about the East Asian miracle in terms of both markets and other institutions, but also to try and understand the historical developments. Government is not a neutral, omnipotent agent that can correct market or organizational failures. Government itself is constrained in its capacity to process information. Also, government itself is an agent, or more correctly, a collection of agents with particular interests and incentives molded through private sector interactions under particular developmental and historical conditions. In short, government is not a neutral arbiter exogenously attached to the economic system to correct the failure of private coordination, but is an endogenous, that is to say, integral element of the system with the same informational and incentive constraints as other economic agents in the system. Therefore, the effectiveness of government in promoting the efficiency of private coordination cannot be taken for granted. From such a perspective, we all recognize that comparative institutional analysis can be a useful approach. In contrast to the conventional approach, based on a market-government dichotomy, we assert the importance of taking the role of institutions, including but not limited to markets, seriously, and analyzing the workings of those institutions with the same rigor as markets. Then they go on to briefly describe each of the chapters, and I'd strongly recommend that you all read these descriptions, because we're not going to be reading every chapter in this book, but I seriously believe that this is a very, very critical book. Even though it came out about 25 years ago, it's still relevant for understanding the relationship between state processes and development.
Economists use the word coordination failures, meaning something quite subtle in the macroeconomy, where, for instance, producers aren't able to find the right consumers, or they're having difficulty with supply chains, or there's some sort of pessimistic expectations. People are having difficulty finding workers, etc., etc. So what this ends up meaning is that the market adjusts itself to a suboptimum equilibrium. And that leads to conditions of economic development that are suboptimal.